it, but I'll say it once again. So what is acid rain? It is the rainfall made sufficiently acidic by atmospheric pollution that it causes environmental harm, typically to forests and lakes. That is, of course, it affects everyone, but the forests and the lakes are the one which get much affected by the acid rain. So how will that help you? It means that it possesses elevated levels of hydrogen ions, that is low pH. When you tell that any liquid is acidic, matlab uska low pH hai, pH level bahut low hai, 7 se kam hai, I mean. Okay, and there is increase in the level of H plus ion. If you remember what we used to write as pH, pH is log to the base 10 1 by H plus ion concentration, yeah, minus log to the base 10 H plus ion concentration. So everything is related to the H plus ions concentration. The more the H plus ions concentration, the more is the less is the pH, the more is the acidic substance, acidic liquid, anything. Okay. So this acid rain can have harmful effects on plants, aquatic animals, and infrastructure. So here the pH scale, just for your understanding, it is given that how you below 7 you call it as the acidic part, and below more than 7 is the basic part. Okay, and what are things when you talk about acidic liquids? Okay, so below pH 7, so those are various like urine, black coffee, tomato juice, grapefruit, lemon juice, hydrochloric acid, battery acids. So these are the examples given. The less is the pH, the more is the acidic thing. Okay, and for each pH level, the example is given. Okay, so you understand how acid rain will be, to what extent the acid rain will be acidic. The acid rain pH is around 3 to 4. Like here it is written, the normal rain is 5 to 7 or 8 till, but acid rain, the pH is 3 to 4. Okay, so that is that much acidic it is. Okay. So how is it caused? Acid rain is caused by emissions of sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide, the two main important pollutants causing the acid rain. So acid rain is caused by emissions of sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide, which react with the water molecules in the atmosphere to produce acids. Okay, nitrogen oxides can also be produced naturally by lightning strikes, and sulfur dioxide is produced by volcanic eruptions. So naturally also these pollutants are emitted into the atmosphere, but other than that there are other sources also, like the industrial, like the vehicle emissions, from which these substances, these gases are emitted. But naturally also it is produced by lightning strikes and by volcanic eruptions. The chemicals in the acid rain can cause the paint to peel. Okay, and corrosion of steel structure and erosion of stone statues. So when you talk about effect on the property, so chemicals in the acid rain, these chemicals, that is nitrogen oxides and sulfur dioxide, can cause the paint to peel, correct? Paint nikal jata hai, corrosion of steel structure and erosion of the stone statues. Okay, so here very simple diagram it is given, that how the sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, okay, those emitted from the industries, from the vehicular emissions, they then combine with the water, water droplets, water vapor, and form and by oxidation then they form this nitric acid and sulfuric acid, which comes down in the form of rain. Okay, in that the water of the rain thus is nothing but the nitric acid and the sulfuric acid. Okay, so the same reaction, that is oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, when react with the water, okay, they form the specific acids. Okay, like we told that nitrous oxides can also be produced naturally due to lightning, and sulfur dioxide due to volcanic eruptions. So the heavy impact, that is the increased amounts of nitrous oxide and sulfur dioxide in the air, do contribute to heart and lung problems, including the asthma and bronchitis. That is, it's not the acid, it's the gases present in the atmosphere that we inhale. Okay, the environmental effect of acid rain has been loss of fish in the acid sensitive lakes and streams. Acid rain has eliminated insect life and some fish species including the brook trout and the creeks in some lakes, streams, etc. Yesterday in the first slide, we had seen that acid rain has a lot of effect on the plants and on the lakes. So on the lakes is the aquatic life that is going to get destroyed. This is a specific pH range for every aquatic life. Like there is a trout fish which we is comfortable, the habitat is comfortable in pH 5 to 6.5. Similarly, there are other aquatic life who are comfortable in the, who can live in the aquatic life with such pH. From pH 4 to pH 6.5 is the maximum. Okay, but at least is the pH 4 where they can, the frogs can survive. But since you know that acid rain pH is very low, and that is why the aquatic life would be disturbed, and this aquatic life could not survive there. At pH lower than 5, most fish eggs will not hatch, and lower pH can kill the adult fish. It reduces the alkalinity and increases the acidity of the water. Of course, acid mixed with any other liquid will make that liquid also acidic, correct? Chronic acidification may reduce the levels of nutrients such as the calcium, which may weaken the fish and other plants. So aquatic life, in the sense, it's all the aquatic animals as well as the aquatic plants, because it's going to reduce this acid rain is also going to reduce the useful nutrients from the lake or the any water source. Acid rain may remove soil nutrients such as the calcium and magnesium from the soils in high elevation forests. In spring, when the snow melts, it will be more acidic than normal. So the same thing, like we had seen in the first slide, that acid rain is harmful for, more harmful for the lakes, that is the water sources, and the forest areas, because the major reason is it is going to reduce the nutrients in both the areas. Like when acid rain is dripped on the soil, okay, when it is received on the soil, maybe in the form of rain, maybe in the form of snow, it also reduces the soil nutrients such as the calcium and magnesium from the soils, which are actually required, okay, for the plants. So therefore it affects the growth of the plants also. So they have given the acidity effects on the baby trout, that is a fish. So as the pH lowers, the life is reducing. And acid rain effects on the sculptures. See, you can see here in 1908, the sculpture used to look like this, and due to the frequent acid rains, okay, where this structure is exposed to the acid rains, because of which there is peeling off of the paint, jo humne bola tha, ya pitting of the structures. Okay, so in 1969, within this almost 60 years, the structure has got deteriorated. Similarly, you could see this structure as well. Okay, so these are few of the effects when you talk about properties on the structures. So these are a few of the effects of the acid rain. So preventions. So how you can prevent the formation of this acid rain? That is, first is the vehicle emission control, reduces the emission of the nitrogen oxides from the motor vehicles. So that you know. First of all is prevention, correct? So that is, at first place itself, how you can reduce the emission of such pollutants. Okay, so that fluidized bed combustion also reduces the amount of sulfur emitted by power production from the industries. From the industries where this pollutants are released, there at the release section, you are supposed to provide an equipment wherein the smoke or the air or the exhaust gets filtered out before it is released into the atmosphere. So fluidized bed combustion is a technique where the combustion of these pollutants happen, and the pollutants are not exposed, are not released into the atmosphere. Likewise, you have a wet scrubber, which is basically a reaction tower equipped with a fan that extracts hot smokestack gases from a power plant into the tower. So this wet scrubber, this is also the equipment that has to be used in the industries, because at first place, at you know, at our position, what you can do is vehicular emission reduction, that we can do. By first of all, reducing the use of the vehicles from for small places, or switching to efficient vehicles which do not let this exhaust into the atmosphere. Either that, at our position, what we can do. But at industry level, where large amount of smoke is released, where large amount of gas is released, large amount of exhaust is released, there you need to provide an equipment which can filter out the exhaust and let the pure air or the filtered air to pass into the atmosphere. So this wet scrubber is also one of the techniques. So wet scrubber is nothing but it takes the concept of your rainfall, the normal rainfall. When you see, when you experience that after rainfall, the atmosphere becomes very clean and very cool, very nice to breathe. You feel the air is so fresh. When the rainfall, when there is rainfall and after rainfall, you feel the atmosphere to be very good, the air to be clean. So why do you feel that? Because there are a lot of pollutants. When there is no rainfall, you could actually experience a lot of pollutants in the atmosphere and you don't feel the air to be, safe. You feel it very dirty. But when there is rainfall, the rain along with it carries the atmospheric pollutants with it and then floods off on the land. Okay, so that is what that is called the scrubbing action. Okay, that there are gases, there are pollutants in the atmosphere, and then they, when water droplets fall in them, along with the water droplets of the rainfall, they are carried away on land and the runoff. Okay, so that is called the scrubbing action. The same thing, say the same scrubbing action concept is followed in industries also, where the smoke or the exhaust is brought in contact with the water. And when they brought into the contact with water, along with the water droplets, water in the sense of the water droplet, the water is sprayed. Okay, spraying of water is done. And along with the water droplets, these pollutants are also carried out, carried along with it. Okay, and then the gas that is released outside, just say after rainfall, you feel the atmosphere is fresh, fresh. Right? Same after the scrubbing action in the industry, the air that is then passed into the atmosphere, that is the clean or the purified air. Okay, so wet scrubber is basically a reaction tower equipped with a fan that extracts hot smoke stack gases from a power plant into the tower. Lime or limestone slurry is also injected into the tower to mix the stack gases and combine with sulfur dioxide present this way. Okay, so that is water droplets are let and the gas gets mixed into the water droplets. And then this water is let outside. Or you can also use this limestone slurry. That limestone slurry also you can use. And the waste gases from the power station. So whatever the pollutants are, they will get mixed with this lime slurry. Okay. And the gas that is released outside will be the clean gas. And then the pollutants along with this limestone slurry, they will be taken outside. Acid rain reacts with metals and rocks such as limestone. Buildings and statues are damaged as a result. Acid rain damages the waxy layer on the leaves of the trees and makes it more difficult for trees to absorb the minerals they need for the healthy growth. So that is also one of the damage on the plant life. Okay, of course it has damage on the buildings, on the statues, everything. But there is damage, a lot of damage on the lakes and the plants as well. For human life, at the start itself, before even formation of the acid rain, those gases present in the atmosphere, there itself the problem starts. There itself the problem starts with the human health. Okay. Later, when this acid rain is formed, of course, there are different problems. The plants may die as a result because they are not get because it is very difficult for them to absorb the minerals. And acid rain also makes rivers and lakes too acidic for some aquatic life to survive. So that is all the summary of what.
What is acid rain? Acid rain is any form of precipitation with high levels of nitric and sulfuric acids. It can occur in the form of snow, fog, and even dry materials that settle to Earth. Most acid rain is caused by human activities. When people burn fossil fuels, sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxides are released into the atmosphere. These gases react with water, oxygen, and other substances to form sulfuric and nitric acid. Winds may spread these acidic solutions over hundreds of miles. After it falls to Earth, acid rain enters water systems as runoff and sinks into the ground. This can make water toxic to crayfish, clams, fish, and other aquatic animals. The rest of the food chain, including non-aquatic species such as birds, is often affected as well. Acid rain also harms forests by damaging trees' leaves, robbing the soil of essential nutrients, and making it hard for trees to take up water. By designing cleaner power plants and using fewer fossil fuels, we can reduce the number of pollutants that create acid rain.
So that was a very small part related to acid rain, which was a common thing that we had seen it previously as well. Okay, so then you have the topic of disasters. Not everything you just have related to man-made disaster, because we are saying in this environment management subject that how we have affected the environment. Okay, so it is all our actions that we are going to see in this subject. Okay, so you have related to man-made disaster. Okay, and this disaster part, if you had the institute level elective of DMM in the last semester, that time also you had we had gone through this different types of disasters also. Okay, so this would be like a revision of your last semester, but you just have about man-made disaster and not the other part. Okay, so what is man-made disaster? It is a disastrous event caused directly and principally by one or more identifiable, deliberate or negligent human actions. Of course, if I set a property on fire, that's a deliberate action. Okay, that is also a disaster. If there is any technological failure in any industry, okay, so that could be because of the negligence. Correct. So a disastrous event caused directly or principally by one or more identifiable, deliberate or negligent human actions. They are intentionally or unintentionally. All kinds of man-made disaster affect a person's mental, physical and social well-being. Of course, mainly they affect the loss of life, the damage to the nation's economy, social disruptions, long-term damage and widespread effects. For example, the nuclear explosion, which has a long-term damage and widespread effects. Okay, so that nuclear explosion is also one of the man-made disaster, correct? Then, so man-made disaster model given by a professor, according to him, disasters arise from an interaction between the human and organizational arrangements of the socio-technical systems set up to manage complex and ill-structured risk problems. Okay, so they arise when there's interaction between the human and the organizational arrangements of socio-technical systems set up to manage complex and ill-structured risk problems. Technological disasters are usually associated with man-made infrastructure and are typically accidental. That is like the Bhopal gas tragedy. So that is same thing, man-made associated with man-made infrastructure and are typically accidental. Consequences of natural disasters can be increased as a result of technological advancement and human activities such as agriculture and forestry. Current interest is safety culture. Here it should have been man-made. The consequences of the man-made disasters and natural disasters as well, both are occurring, increasing due to the result of technological advancement and the human activities. Then, the human-induced disasters given by NDMP, that is National Disaster Management Plan. Okay, so NDMP notes that rise in population, rapid urbanization and industrialization, development within the high-risk zones, environmental degradation and climate change aggravates the vulnerabilities to various kinds of disasters. Due to inadequate disaster preparedness, communities and animals are at increased risk from many kinds of human-induced hazards arising from accidents. It might be industrial, road, air, rail, or on river, or on sea, or any building collapse, or fires, mine flooding, oil spills, etc. Okay. Then chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear, CBRN hazards. Okay, chemical, biological, radiological hazards rank very high in among the human-induced risk. Terrorist attacks or terrorist activities and secondary incidents add to this risk and call for adequate preparedness and planning. Okay, so these are the things when you talk about human-induced disasters. Okay. So our area or becomes more vulnerable to the disasters because there is rise in population. These are the things which increase the vulnerability. Okay, so increase in the population, rapid urbanization, industrialization, development within high-risk zones, environmental degradation, climate change. These are the things which make any area more prone, more vulnerable to various kinds of disaster. Also, inadequate disaster preparedness. No proper training, no proper preparedness to face a disaster. Communities and animals are at increased risk from many kinds of human-induced arising accidents. Like for, just say, here examples, the industrial road. Right? If you don't know how to deal with that disaster, if there is a fire, but you don't know how to set that, how to send extinguish, you don't know how to even operate a fire extinguisher, a simple thing. Okay, and there is a fire outbreak. You are not given the training to how to face this such situation. Okay, so then inadequate disaster preparedness is that thing, and then the community is more prone, is at more risk to such kind of disasters. Okay, also when you talk about human-induced disasters, of course the extent of the disaster we measured from the risk and the effect of the disaster. So chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear, these hazards which I have they are the topmost high ranking in the human induced risk because their risk scope is too much, their effect lasts for longer time, and the effects are too high. Okay. And then other terrorist activities, secondary incidents add to this risk and call for adequate preparedness and planning. Okay. So, when you talk about National Disaster Management Plan, NDMP, okay, related to the different types of disaster, you have a ministry or a department who looks after this. Okay, right from, right from giving training, right from facing the disaster, right from recovery of rehabilitation from that disaster, the whole thing, the whole process of disaster management is taken into account by a specific department for a specific type of disaster. Like you have biological disaster, so that is taken care by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. You have chemical and industrial disaster, so that is taken by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. When you have civil aviation accidents, it's the Ministry of Civil Aviation. Cyclone, tornado, it's the Ministry of Earth Sciences. Then tsunami, Ministry of Earth Science. Drought, hailstorm, cold wave, forest, pet attack, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. Earthquake, again, Ministry of Earth Sciences. Then flood, Ministry of Water Resources. Forest fire, the Ministry of Environment, Forest, Climate Change. Then you have landslides, that is the Ministry of Mines. Avalanche breakdown, so Ministry of Defense. Nuclear and radiological emergencies, so it is a Department of Atomic Energy. Rail accidents, Ministry of Railways. Road accidents, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. Urban floods, Ministry of Urban Development. So like this whole thing, the whole disaster management thing actually comes on the Ministry of Home Affairs. See here. The first thing that we had seen about how the vulnerability is increased, vulnerability of this disaster is increased in that area, and this is given by National Disaster Management Plan, and this National Disaster Management Plan is under National Disaster Management Authority, okay, who makes this National Disaster Management Plan, and the higher authority to this National Disaster Management Plan, it is the Ministry of Home Affairs under which it is considered. Okay, so Ministry of Home Affairs is the main, and from that for different types of disaster, to control different types of disaster, to look over the various type of different disaster, each department is made, each nodal ministry is made, which takes care of those specific disasters. And there can be various causes, there can be various reasons for man-made disaster, like ignorance, carelessness, unawareness, illiteracy, strikes, human error, tourism, terrorism, vandalism, okay, weapons, water, sewage overflow, chemicals, etc. And there can be many, many more. Okay. So these are the causes or the reasons because of which there can be man-made disasters. Okay. So all these things, you know, you take any kind of disaster, you know the purpose, at least you must have read the purpose, the cause or the reason behind it. Okay, vandalism is nothing but when deliberately there is any destruction of any property. Okay, so that is called the property, or maybe private property, or maybe any other public property. When there is deliberate destruction of any property, that is vandalism. Okay. Then the following factors that contribute to the inevitability of the man-made disaster. Inevitability in the sense, like inevitable, when you call a thing, it is inevitable, that it is bound to occur. Okay, that confirms, that makes a surety, that iske wajah se to confirm hoga hai. Okay, so those factors which contribute to the inevitability, sureness that it is going to happen of man-made disaster, is size and population density of the cities and overcrowding, intensive utilization of rapid forms of mass transport. Of course, matlab these, of course, these are the factors, these are the reasons causing the man-made disaster, but these are the sure factors that are surely going to affect, even if you don't do anything and just sit. Okay, even if you don't literate yourself, if you don't educate yourself, okay, then too, these are the things like size and population intensity of the cities, overcrowding, intensive utilization of rapid forms of mass transport, okay, poorly organized emergency services, lack of warning to the people, use of high technology source of energy, increasing pressure to mine fossil fuels. So these are the factors which are sure going to contribute to the evolution of the man-made disaster and increase the effect of the man-made disaster. So general categorization of man-made disaster is those in which disaster occurred in circumscribed community. Okay, like for example, they have given a landslide in the form of slurry occurred at a mining site, okay, during rain, that killed workers and their family and the family members who are present at that time. Okay, so that is called the circumscribed community which were present there. Then you have another, okay, those in which victims of the disaster did not come from a circumscribed community, for example, transportation disasters, oil rig fires, etc. Okay, that is first where the disaster occurs and the effect of the disaster is limited to that particular area, to that particular community. Okay, so the limit, there is a limit of effect, so that is called the circumscribed community. So where they have given an example that because of the landslide, it was only the people who were, not just only, I mean, it was limited to the people who were actually working on that mining site, and they got affected, the people, the family who were present there at that time. But there are other human induced disasters or man made disasters where the victims of the disaster, the people affected from the disaster, did not come from the circumscribed community. I mean, they were not part of the disaster, they were not present at that particular place. For example, transportation disasters and oil rig fires. Okay, if there is any fire outbreak, oil rig fire to such an extent, okay, that it is going to affect the nearby areas also. So you were not part of that fire, you were not part of that company where the fire outbreak happened, but it is getting affected, but it is the people around it are getting affected. So that becomes the circum they did not come from the circumscribed community, but they are the victims of the disaster. There are different types of man-made disasters like structural collapse, transportation accidents, oil spills, arson, that is fire, damaging the property or anything by fire, okay, by intentionally fire outbreak, okay, war, terrorist attacks and deforestation and desertification, power outage, economic collapse, epidemic, fire accidents, industrial accidents, and the CBRN, chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear hazards that we had seen. Okay, that full form we had already seen. So these are the types of man-made disasters. So a few of the photos, when you talk about each and every disaster, or maximum of this disaster, you have seen it in and around you. Okay, so those are all man-made disasters. That is this oil spill. Okay. Arson, see, fire to a property. Intentionally or unintentionally, that is the arson. Then terrorist attack. Deforestation, major issue. See, between 1990 to 2015, okay. Between 1990 to 2015, that is in within 25 years, the world lost 129 million hectares of forest area. That is the area, that is almost an area the size of South Africa. So that much forest is lost. Then, structural collapse is also one of the human-induced disaster, man-made disaster, correct? So, structural collapses are often caused by engineering failure. Sudden fall down or cave in of any type of structure due to various natural reasons, maybe corrosion attack, floods, tsunami, tornado, or artificial reason like terrorist attack, under-design, arson, etc. is called the structural failure or the structural collapse. Such as building collapse, bridge collapse, dam failure, balcony collapse, etc. So that all comes under the structural collapse. So these are few of the photos of structural collapse, bridge and balcony collapse. Building collapse are designed to support certain loads without deforming excessively. The loads are the weights of the people and the object. When you talk about load on the building, so they are supposed to be designed considering such loads. And causes of the building collapse are bad design, faulty construction, foundation failure, extraordinary load, unexpected failure mode, combination of these causes. Okay, so these are certain causes of the building collapse. So the collapse of the structures, including the building, may result in death or serious injury to employees and the public. It may damage the adjacent property. There is a loss of a lot of property as well. Property, right? Immediate action is take for injuries and administer first aid. Don't move seriously injured individuals. Communicate number and identity of missing people to emergency services. Don't enter damaged or unstable building to search for missing people. So that is about the building collapse when there is building collapse. So what are the effects and what are the immediate actions to be followed, because that is majority what we see around us, building collapse thing. So for the structural collapse, what are the prevention and the remedies can be followed? Always hire the professional for building design and construction work. When building any high-rising structure, don't manage, use right amount and good quality of the material. Understanding about the reinforcement, foundation, okay. Then using the right steel, the big difference between different sizes of the steel. Then use the right concrete mix ratio. So this is all the civil techniques that whenever they, because structural collapse is a very, very important and very crucial thing that needs attention, because it is going to not just going to affect the property, the people, and lot more of people living there, not just a single family any or anything. Okay, so for this particular thing, okay, so various concepts, technical concepts need to be taken into account when you are supposed to build any structure. poor structural design and building plan, excessive alteration, don't change the plan too much during the construction. Okay, there is lack of adherence to specifications by unqualified and unskilled personnel. So that happens when there is faulty construction. A few photos of this building collapse. So when you talk about transportation accident, which is also a human-induced effect, so in that you have road accidents where traffic collision are the leading cause of death, and road-based pollution creates a substantial health hazard, especially in major conurbations. Okay, so that also you are aware. Every day we hear about some road accidents, correct? So you know what all these things are. Okay, especially in major conurbation, especially when there is several, a lot more of areas are connected to each other. So that is called the major conurbations. Road networks are developed for better connectivity and service. Increased number of vehicles, violation of the traffic rules, speeding, all this drunken driving, poor maintenance of vehicle, all these things are the causes of the road accidents, correct? And the safety measures, which you already know, in order, because at our level, of course, we are not going to, like, you are sitting at home, but you are not aware of the faulty construction done in your area, so you cannot do anything in that. But where you can actually put your efforts is this one thing, road accident. Because every day you are, maximum of us drive on roads, correct? So we know all these things. We already know. See, use the zebra crossing or use the seat belt or everything, we are aware of all the rules actually. Okay, helmet and everything. Okay, it's just that we don't follow it properly. So at our level, what best what we can do is following all the rules while you are traveling on road. And railroad disaster is an occurrence associated with the operation of a passenger train, which results in substantial loss of life. Usually, accidents with the freight that is a good trains are not considered disasters unless they cause substantial loss of life and property. Okay, so when there is actually loss of any life, loss of any property, at that time only that particular phenomenon is called as disaster. But for example, if there is a goods train, that is a train which is carrying goods, okay, and if there is any failure or any accident, but it has not caused any effect on any people, of any person, on any person, or nor has disturbed any property, so that would not cause as a disaster. But other rails which are actually carrying the passengers, if there is any failure, if there is any accident in for that particular rail, okay, for that particular train, so then that is the rail accident. The most common type of rail accident is derailment. Derailment due to human error, sabotage, or natural landslide in a hilly track or fire outbreak. So again, this rail accidents can be classified into mechanical failure, manual error, civil work failure, the reason behind it. Okay. It can be further classified, the railroad accident, rail accident basically, head-on collision, rear-end collision, derailment, driver's error, signal man's error, poor design and maintenance, depending upon the cause. Okay, obstruction on the railway line, fire and explosion, fall from the train, civil engineering works failure, terrorism, suicidal act, all those things. Okay, so common causes are trains or parts that are defective, negligence, crossing that are unprotected, safety gates not in place, inadequate maintenance of track, sabotage or terror attack that is intentionally done, intentionally destruction of the property, bad weather because of the fog, there might be accidents, failing mechanisms, malfunction train and signal lights or signals or lights. Okay, so all this you know that it is because of these reasons that the rail accidents occur. There are certain consequences and effects when you talk about rail accidents, and there are certain safety measures to be followed. Okay, do not at railway crossing pay attention to the signal and the swing barrier. Do not get underneath or try to get across. Okay, get down from the vehicle and look at either side of the track before crossing. Do not carry any inflammable material. Do not lean out of a moving train. Do not smoke in train. Do not pull the emergency cord unnecessarily. So these are the simple safety measures that need to be followed, because the phenomenon is not simple. The phenomenon is not that it could be neglected. We all know what are the reasons, what could be the reason, what could be the different things that could be followed in order to avoid such rail accidents. It's just that we are aware of it, but we don't follow it. So we need to give it very too much attention on this. Then there can be aviation or air accidents, which is also a human-induced, that is a man-made disaster. That is, an aviation incident is an occurrence other than an incident associated with the operation of an aircraft, which affects or could affect the safety of operations, passengers, or pilots. Okay, air accident may occur due to technical problems, fire, poor landing and takeoff, weather conditions, hijacking, bombing, etc. So this could be various reasons for air accidents. Then sea travel accidents, that is, ships can sink, capsize, in the upside down it can happen, correct? Or crashing disaster. Perhaps the most infamous sinking was that of the Titanic, which hit an iceberg and sank, resulting in the worst maritime disasters in the history. So we know, everyone knows about the historic moment where there was a major sea accident, ship accident, okay, of the Titanic. So those could be the reasons. The space accidents, there is a space travel presents significant hazards, mostly to the direct participants. Participants will those who are actually going into the space, the astronauts or the cosmonauts, and the ground support personnel, but also carry the potential of disaster to the public at large, because they are carrying something that is going to be useful to the whole country or to the whole world. Okay, so they might they are carrying something that is going to be could be a disaster to the public at large as well. Okay, so accidents can occur on the ground during launch preparation or in flight due to equipment malfunction or naturally hostile environment of space itself. An additional risk is posed by low orbiting satellites whose orbits eventually decay due to friction with the extremely thin atmosphere. If they are large enough, these massive pieces traveling at great speed can fall to the earth before burning up, with the potential to do the damage. So this could be various reasons when you talk about space accident. Okay, so the various risk or various reasons that are associated with the risk or with the disaster are this. Okay, so that's all about, you know, just briefing out about the various man-made disasters, the consequences, the causes, effects, and then what at our place, what we can do in order to avoid such type of.
Sometimes things are out of our control, but sometimes we have no one to blame but ourselves. Welcome to WatchMojo.com, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 worst man-made environmental disasters. Before we begin, we publish new videos every day, so be sure to subscribe for more great content. For this list, we're looking at the most catastrophic environmental situations that humanity has put themselves through in recent years. Number 10, the Exxon Valdez oil spill. On March 24, 1989, an Exxon-owned oil tanker called the Exxon Valdez struck Bligh Reef off the coast of Alaska just after midnight. The collision occurred in Prince William Sound, a remote area nearly inaccessible to emergency response crews. In the days that followed, 10.8 million U.S. gallons of crude oil poured into the sea, in what is now the second most significant spill ever on U.S. territory after 2010's Deepwater Horizon spill. Wildlife in the area was strongly affected, with hundreds of thousands of birds and mammals dying, and the effect on sea life not even calculated. Decades later, the fauna of the area is still impacted by this environmental catastrophe. Number 9, the shrinking of the Aral Sea. What was once one of Earth's largest lakes has now been reduced to an almost entirely dry basin after Soviet irrigation projects rerouted the rivers that fed into it. This process began in the 1960s and steadily reduced the size of the lake to the point that the Eastern Basin is now known as the Arakam Desert. Recently, efforts have been made to replenish the sea with water, but it will take many years to undo the damage that's been done. Number 8, the Bhopal disaster. In December 1984, a gas leak at the Union Carbide India Limited pesticide plant in Bhopal, India, exposed over 500,000 people to methyl isocyanate and other dangerous chemicals. The number of fatalities resulting from the incident has been disputed, with totals ranging from 4,000 to over 16,000. Either way, the death toll makes this the number one most deadly industrial disaster in human history. It's still unknown what caused this incident, but as of 2014, there were still hundreds of thousands of people reportedly suffering due to fallout from the leak. Number 7. Electronic waste in Guiyu, China. There's a collection of villages in the Guangdong province of China that's known as the largest site of electronic waste in the world. Guiyu comprises a 20-square-mile area, and as of 2005, there were over 60,000 people employed there. The processing and recycling of the electronics creates a hazardous environment for those in the area, with locals suffering from a battery of diseases and disorders, including lead poisoning and high miscarriage rates. What was once a fertile rice-producing region is now incapable of food production because the water is so seriously contaminated. Number 6. The Great Smog of London. Some people think of London's weather as stereotypically gloomy, but it's rarely been as bad as this. At the end of 1952, a mix of weather conditions and coal pollution caused the city of London to be enshrouded in a veil of smog for 5 days. Though the issue was relatively short-lived, modern historians estimate that approximately 12,000 people perished as a direct result of the smog. However, this event did spur politicians to take air pollution more seriously, resulting in the Clean Air Act being enacted 4 years later. Number 5. The Deepwater Horizon oil spill. In April of 2010, an explosion took place on an oil drilling rig 40 miles off the coast of Louisiana. The resulting disaster was the BP oil spill, also known as the Deepwater Horizon spill, which sent 210 million U.S. gallons of oil into the Gulf of Mexico. Of the 126-member crew, 17 were injured, with 11 never recovered, and presumed dead. It's thought to be the largest marine oil spill related to the oil industry in history. For the damage caused, BP paid $18.7 billion to the U.S. government, making it the most significant corporate settlement in U.S. history as well. Number 4. Castle Bravo. What was meant to be an innocuous secret trial of a then-untested hydrogen bomb turned into a serious problem on March 1, 1954. The U.S. chose the Marshall Islands region of Micronesia to test their experiment. Within moments of the bomb's detonation, a fireball almost 4.5 miles wide was created, and the resulting mushroom cloud towered 47,000 feet in the air. The detonation of Castle Bravo was about 1,000 times as powerful as the atomic bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki during World War II. With a serious amount of unforeseen radiation, the fallout affected almost 1,200 residents of the surrounding islands. Number 3. Ecocide Vietnam. During the 1960s and 70s, the environment was seriously impacted by the Vietnam War. In an operation called Operation Ranch Hand, the U.S. military sprayed a mix of chemicals referred to as Agent Orange to destroy forests in Vietnam. Exposure to these chemicals by humans can be toxic, with health problems like cancers, birth defects, and nervous system disorders directly related to that exposure. These issues affected American soldiers, but the brunt of the damage was done to the Vietnamese people. It's estimated that hundreds of thousands were either killed or made ill by Agent Orange. Number 2. The Kuwaiti oil fires. During the Persian Gulf War of the early 1990s, the U.S. and other coalition countries went to war with Iraq following Iraq's invasion of Kuwait. In 1991, after the coalition's invasion, the retreating Iraqi military set fire to several hundred oil wells as well as oil lakes in Kuwait. The fires burned for months, causing massive environmental devastation. What's more, the low air quality caused by the burning oil incited respiratory issues in both soldiers and civilians who were in proximity to the fires. Before we unveil our pick for the worst man-made environmental disaster, here are some dishonorable mentions. Number 1. The Chernobyl disaster. On April 26, 1986, the Chernobyl nuclear power plant in what was then the USSR was undergoing tests where their backup safety systems were intentionally turned off. A faulty reactor malfunctioned, and what ensued was a graphite fire that caused massive radiation to flood the surrounding areas. It's still unknown what the long-term health effects will be for those in the area, but hundreds of thousands of people were displaced and relocated due to the catastrophe. It was only in 2011, 25 years later, that nearby areas became open